The following program is classified G. It's suitable for all ages. We would like to remind our viewers that the views expressed in this program by our participating guests are solely viewpoints of them who take part and does not reflect the views and beliefs of the Derana Media Network. This is an opinion-based program.
On an all-new Get Real, the sport of the people. With cricket taking center stage once again with the second round of the ICC Test Championships currently underway, all eyes are on the 11 sides hoping to bring glory to the nation. This sport has embedded so much in our society that many worldwide think that it's our national sport. However, just like a good thing, it has not been with its ups and downs. With the 2023 World Cup just 2 years away, can Sri Lanka get back to its former glory and bring a win back to this nation? What are the areas that needs to be ironed out to reach the pinnacle of success? For expert opinions tonight, I'm honored to welcome to the program former Sri Lanka cricket captain and ICC Elite Panel match referee and member of the 1996 ICC Cricket World Cup winning team for Sri Lanka, Roshan Mahanama.
Real views, real opinions, and for an honest conversation, this is Get Real, and it all starts right now.
From Studio 24, with opinions that matter, it's time to get real with Mahieash Johnney.
A very good evening, everyone. Thanks for once again making time to join me on a Monday night where I ask you to get real with me on issues facing everyday Sri Lankans. Tonight, I want to focus on Sri Lanka cricket, a sport we all love so much, and more on the importance of mindset change to better the future of this nation and also the sport. We will focus closely on this matter in our real story segment, but in my opening statement, I want to comment on a development that occurred last week and ask you this simple question. Does that poison taste good? Well, on the 24th of this month, the government had to rescind its April 26 ban on chemical fertilizer. In my opinion, the ban was one of the boldest moves taken by a head of state in recent times. In his capacity as the commander-in-chief, the president bowed down to public pressure and gave in to what the government initially called an ironclad ban.
ඉතින් ඒක අපි කොටසකට හරි ඒ තියෙන එක ඉමීඩියට් විසඳුමක් අපිට දෙන්න වෙනවා. හැබැයි ප්‍රතිපත්තියක් වශයෙන් රජයේ අපි කරන්නේ හරිත කෘෂි කර්මාන්තය පමණයි. ඒක තමයි අපි ඉදිරියට ගෙනියන්නේ.
Well, I cannot entirely agree with the president's move, but then again, I'm not the president. And if the president chooses to listen to his people, well, then that's his choice. Now, yes, we have to agree there were many missteps in the initial launch of the program. Of course, all the naysayers say they should have done this in this way or that way, especially the clown clan and the opposition. But that's in a perfect world. We are educated enough to know that we might not get everything right in the first round. Yet, the opposition speaks as if they are so perfect in executing any matter. We all know how they executed the 5 years under their governance, which resulted in a broken economy, depleted security, and a horrible country to live in. All right, let's talk about the ban for a moment. In his election manifesto, the president said that he's more interested in engaging in green agriculture, meaning the president's administration will engage in agriculture that's less harmful to humans. So the translation of that is he's going to take steps to reduce the number of toxic chemicals in our food systems, which has been one of the leading causes for non-communicable diseases here in Sri Lanka, especially CKD, chronic kidney disease. So he banned the use of chemical fertilizer and forced our farmers to use organic fertilizer instead. Of course, there were problems in the execution. However, we need to understand what was the real intention of this move. basically what the ban, what is the president is trying to say with this ban that he have taken. He's simply saying, for the love of Christ, stop eating poison. That's it. The ban was meant to tell you and me, even our farmers, to stop the small or medium or whatever quantity usage of chemicals that are very harmful to our bodies to be used in our food cultivation, to stop. Because just because you did it for many, many years doesn't mean it's right. So this man is asking us to stop eating poison. No sooner the ban came into effect, the clown clan of the opposition saw it as another opportunity to create disruption and chaos, milk the situation for their petty purpose, and started fueling farmers to protest against the ban. For a moment, think, if the opposition claims that they love the people and are fighting for the people, shouldn't they be the first to tell you to stop eating poison? Oh no. They don't care whether you eat poison or whether your kids be victims of any type of disaster in the future. That does not matter, as long as they can use the moment to milk towards their petty purpose. Well, that's what matters. So you got to ask the question, does the opposition really have the best interest of us, the people? In short, we as a nation, instead of launching a war against the use of chemical in our food systems, our agriculture, what did we do? We launched a war against the man who asked us not to eat poison. We did everything possible to prove him wrong, thinking that siding with the clown clan and demonstrating that the president is wrong would eventually be a victory for us all. Instead of fighting with the farmers and forcing them to stop using chemicals in our food system, we fought the man who asked us to do the right thing. We should all feel proud about our nation, shouldn't we? Next time when you are at the supermarket buying produce, think about your children and ask this question. How comfortable are you feeding poison to your kids? Then ask yourself this question as well. Who's the real winner here at the end? Is it the president who asked us not to eat poison? Or is it the clown clan and the opposition and the big fertilizer companies? Or is it you and me? Next time you look at your kid's face, the answer will be very evident. All right, shortly, I will sit down with my guest tonight, cricketing legend Roshan Mahanama, who is also part of many charities, including breast cancer awareness, prostate cancer awareness, and many more. But before that, as usual, Dani Dubitana was our fax guy is here to talk about something completely different from the organic fertilizer fiasco. Danindu is here to talk about cricket and Sri Lanka cricket. What's your focus on the real story, Danindu?
Introduction to the real story, I think, from something we have noticed in this program is, and given the reset series that we did, some in evaluation of the entire series, something that came out was this need to form unity, for unify the nation. And I think that is where the real story in today's episode starts, and that is where the real story really only goes to, where the role that sports and specifically cricket plays in bringing people together. So sports has been recognized as a great unifier across the world, and especially within Sri Lanka. Amongst the field of sports, cricket holds a place close to the hearts of all Sri Lankans.
Sports have had a unique ability to bring people together in the most incredible ways over history.
Sri Lanka in my lifetime has never been united. The only two examples that I give when I talk is when Sri Lanka played Australia in 1996 for 24 hours, we were Sri Lankans. Muthaiah Muralidharan was not Tamil. Sanat Jayasurya was not from the south. Arjuna Ranatunga was not an Anandian. And Vas was not Catholic. We played as Sri Lanka. I can remember when I took Anuruddha Ratnayake for the Olympic Games, for 8 minutes, Sri Lankans prayed for him. Our factories of nearly 75,000 people came 1 hour before and chanted Pirith, you know, before the fight, which came as a shock to me. So your sports have been a great unifier.
Amongst the sports within our country, cricket has been on the topmost tier, primarily because of the high frequency of competitions. From the inception of cricket in the year 1832, the country has gone ahead to win the 1996 World Cup, which is considered to be one of the greatest moments in the cricketing history of Sri Lanka. Sri Lanka has also won the 2014 T20 World Cup as well. ICC has inducted Muthaiya Muralidharan, Kumar Sangakkara and Mahila Jayawardhana to its Hall of Fame. However, based on the most recent evaluations of the ICC, Sri Lanka's men's cricket team is placed 9th in the ODI rankings, 9th in the T20 rankings and 8th in the Test rankings. The women's team is ranked at 9th in the ODI rankings and 8th in the T20 rankings. Therefore, it is clear that the game we all admire needs to pick up its pace to keep up with its former glory. The current team had seen a reduction in salaries for the year 2021 to 2022. This was witnessed with the introduction of the performance-linked pay system that is being followed by the SLC. As reported by the morning newspaper based on the new categorizations introduced by the SLC, a Category A player will approximately be paid between 900,000 rupees to 1.6 million rupees per month. Meanwhile, a conversation has been raised about the coaching changes within Sri Lanka as well. Sri Lanka previously appointed former Sri Lankan Test player Chandika Hathurusinghe as head coach in December 2017, but he was terminated after the team ended up 6th in the 2019 ODI World Cup. Mickey Arthur, the current coach, will leave after Sri Lanka's two-match home Test series against the West Indies this month. Mickey Arthur's record for the 2 years he coached the team was set at 55 matches participated, out of which 17 were won, 31 lost, 5 drawn and 2 with no results. The win-loss ratio was 0.548. This data is from across all three formats. In assessing these figures, it must be noted that the responsibility is not only on the players and the coaching staff, but the general public as well. The relentless abuse on social media of certain cricketers has played a harmful role in the development of mindset. Domestic football and cricket teams in England recently began a boycotting campaign to deal with the abuses present online.
Take the sports and the actual performance output, a lot of it has come from the outstations over the years, where they, and also too, in Sri Lanka there is an unhealthy focus on cricket. Mm-hmm. You know, yes, we have won a 50-over World Cup, a T20 World Cup. We made countless finals. We are at an elite level in this sport, but that is not the only sport that we are good at. I mean, if you take Olympics. You know, cricket might end up in the Olympics at some point in the near future, but Jasantika Jaisinghe and Duncan White. In the Commonwealth Games, we've won 4 gold medals since its inception. In the Asian Games, only 11 gold medals. But the fact that we are getting to a stage where we can compete with the best in the world is very promising.
A unique opportunity to reform the brand of Sri Lankan cricket has been made available through the Lanka Premier League, which is Sri Lanka's topmost domestic tournament. The Lanka Premier League for 2021 will commence on the 5th of December in Colombo, with the inaugural game scheduled to be played between Gaul and Jaffna teams. The tournament will consist of 24 games and will see the participation of topmost domestic and international cricketers. The Lanka Premier League 2021 will be officiated by a highly recognised match referee panel and umpiring panel led by Chief Match Referee of the ICC, Ranjan Madugalla, who is the first chief referee ever appointed, as it was a new position introduced by the ICC. In the long run, many efforts have been taken by the current sports ministry to develop the quality of cricket within Sri Lanka. Multiple resources have been made available for the local cricketers, such as the Brain Centre, which provides a place to conduct evaluations and high-tech research on competitive teams, in a bid to help improve cricket across the country for all teams and age groups.
The effect cricket has on the people of Sri Lanka can be used to benefit the overall image of the country in the long run. However, that effort will be in vain if the entire population doesn't work together. Mahesh, I think reviewing the real story and reviewing most of the programs we did, working towards unity is something, though it is a difficult topic, it is something that we have to address, and that is something we can address within today's program as well.
Not only for sports, but it trickles down to all other areas. Even if what I've been talking about, the organic fertilizer thing, now that is something we need to understand as a united country, that it is done for our betterment and not some political agenda or anything of that sort. Well, thank you very much with the real story there. Let's take a short commercial break. On the other side, cricketing legend Roshan Mahanama. This is Get Real. Be right back. We'll be right back. one to get real time now to get some context and have a very inspirational conversation with one of the people who have led a winning team, who've been part of the winning team, and who has made Sri Lanka's flag flutter all over the world and make our hearts filled with pride. You know, 1996 is a year that we never forget, because that was the year we won the World Cup. A member of the 1996 ICC Cricket World Cup winning team, Roshan Mahanama, is here. Roshan, thank you very much for accepting our invitation and coming on the show. You're also, you were also the former Sri Lankan cricket captain and also the ICC elite panel match referee. You did a lot of cricket. Now you are taking a little bit, you know, writing books and all, being literate and all. He's written a new book and he's here to talk all about it. The book is titled Roshan Mahanama Retired Her to the Best View of the Game. This book will be published, I think, in the coming weeks, and it is pretty much a life biography of Roshan Mahanama, what he thinks, what it is all about, and how he has come through for this particular game. Roshan, why? Very interesting title, Retired Hurt to be the best view of the game. How can you be the best view of the game if you're retired and hurt? Why did you come with that?
Mahesh, first of all, let me thank Derana for giving me this opportunity. I've stayed out of the media limelight or media attention, and being out of the limelight. There were various reasons for that. When I was with the ICC, that was the greatest thing that happened to me. I feel that the ICC recognized my honesty and integrity by giving me an opportunity to work for the game that I love so passionately. So I'm so grateful to them. And also, that was one of the reasons that I stayed out of media attention, because we were not supposed to do until we get permission from them. I've been out of the ICC for about 6 years now. I stepped down on a matter of principle, where a lot of people would not step down for prestige and money. But I feel in life sometimes you need to stand up for what you feel, what is right. And coming to the book, I wrote a book in the year 2000 or thereabouts. There was a friend of mine, I had just moved out from the game as a player. I was spending time in Australia. My dear friend David Cruz told me that you've done so much from my point of view for Sri Lanka cricket. Why don't you tell the people about what you've been through? And he got me a credible writer to help me with the book, Ken Peace. So with Ken, we did the first book. I spent a lot of time telling him my story, and we released the book in Australia. I know it just took a lot of people by surprise. There were few other things that I had mentioned. Some were of the view that it had a racial overtone, but what I said was I have not fabricated anything. I've just come out with my side of the story, and also to show what really helped little Sri Lanka to win the World Cup in 1996. So we released the first book. When we were looking at a title, my father, who has played the game, followed the game closely, came up with the title. It's a cricketing title, but it can be taken in different ways or in another context as well. So that's why we came with the title Retired Hurt for the first book. Yes, I was not ready for retirement. It came as a surprise, not only to me, but to everyone, because I had trained with the players at the time, the day before and the following day I announced my retirement. And it was done through Sarvodaya Publications. And then later on, I got to know that they have gone out of production. There was a demand for the book. I was on the lookout to get it done. I had got a soft copy. I think I had misplaced, or someone who had taken it had not returned. It was quite a challenge for us to do the book again. And when I was on the lookout, through Captain Elmo Jayawardena, I was able to meet another youngster. Why I say another youngster is because the boy who helped me to do the second part of the book is also a young Thomian. So the youngster who has the who is the publisher of the book is a royalist. He's Darshana Ralapanava. And when I spoke to Darshana Publishers, he said, "Aya, why don't we try and do a revised edition of the book? You have a story. No international match referee has written a book." And he got me thinking, and I thought, yes, might as well. A lot of people wouldn't know the role of the match referee, and I need to put that down. And again, I was on the lookout for someone to help me to write the book. There were a few options. I met Ashan Pieris by accident. I got a liking to him from the first time that I met him. I did a program with him. And after the event, we were socializing. And when I was ready to leave, he said, "If you are ever going to do the book, I'm more than happy to help you to write it." And I just thought I'll park that in my head.
And now we have a proper biography of Roshan Mahanama. One of the chapters in the book, I think, where you talk about the biggest match of our lives, which is for you at that moment was the 96 World Cup winning match that actually brought this, that gave our country at that time, we were in such depths because we were at a war. The country was not doing very well, but everybody rallied, despite the fact whether it's Sinhalese, a Muslim, a Tamil, anyone who was part of Sri Lanka was so proud. And I remember when the final match with Australia, and I think it was a catch and we caught it, and we knew we won the game. Such pride, knowing the fact that such a small country can do such a big thing and capture the world. Sadly, Roshan, when we talk about golden years of cricket or all that, it's this 96 World Cup winning match and that entire era. What has happened to our cricket? Why are we struggling? Why are we not getting into the pinnacle of the sport? That is, we should. We have the talent. We have the people. We have everything what we need right here in our country. But we're not hitting that mark. And if you take countries like Australia, who played against us in 1996, you're pretty much, you know, constantly you're played against. They're still on top form. 1996, they were on top form. Right now, still they are. What do you think? What's going on?
First, I must say that, yes, people can say that the 96 era was the golden era, but I will go
beyond
96 as well. There were quite a lot of brilliant cricketers who represented Ceylon, then Sri Lanka. Unfortunately, we did not have test status. They were not playing in the big league. I'm sure they would have been as good as anyone who were good at the time, but opportunities were less and cricket was more or less a part-time thing for the guys who played in that or played in the good old days.
Yeah.
But the change took place from the time we got test status. So I think we need to recognize the guys who were involved in that period, which opened doors for people like us,
exactly.
And then going beyond. By saying that, I think we have had a slide in the last 3 to 4 years. I would put it down. You were talking about Australia. They do have sustainable systems. When you have systems documented, what you need to do is review them annually. This is what the ICC does. We learned a lot being in the ICC. That's why I said at the outset, one of the greatest things for me was working for the governing body. Mm. They come up with rules, regulations, and it is reviewed annually, and those decisions are reviewed by a cricket committee.
And people who know about the game.
In the cricket committee, they have people who knows about the game, and it is not only people who have just been involved as cricketers. They'll have a match referee, they'll have an umpire, a commentator, but people who have played the game at the highest level. And they meet annually, if needed before that, and they decide what changes or what needs to be maintained or what changes that needs to be done. But here, looking at our cricket board constitution, I don't like to talk about it, Mahesh, but just because you asked me, every time an elected body comes in to power, they say they have a high-powered cricket committee. From what I know, there is no status for the cricket committee in the cricket board constitution. So who makes these decisions, right? When we were playing, maybe prior to that, they would have had very limited clubs, 8 to 10. But from what I remember, when I was playing, I think we had about 12 teams. Now we have 26 teams. It's been diluted. Why have they done it? Not to promote the game in that sense. We need to look into those areas and come up with sustainable systems. We've been very lucky. Until recently, we've been producing cricketers through our school system. Mm. We've got a very strong school system, but by saying that, how many times have we won an Under-19 World Cup? How many times have we made it to the knockout stage of an Under-19 World Cup? When I told you that I stayed out of the media attention or limelight, people might get the impression, oh, these people are staying out and talking. So that's the reason I never came out to speak about what I felt. Because I feel to do what you feel what is right, you have to have a like-minded group, and you need to have authority. With the system, I doubt it whether we'll get that authority to make the changes that we feel that needs to happen for the betterment of the game. Everyone says that we are here for the betterment of the game.
But where's the betterment?
But where's the betterment then?
True. Right. I want to talk more about about Sri Lanka cricket and our status, and how what can you give and say in order to change, like what you said, you know, bringing in systems, reviewing them, and understanding exactly where we went wrong, and if we did something right, continuously keep doing that. Let's take a short commercial break. You're watching Get Real. I'm in conversation with cricketing legend Roshan Mahanama. We'll be right back. To Get Real. I'm in conversation with cricketing legend Roshan Mahanama, former Sri Lanka cricket captain and ICC elite Tamil match referee, member of the 1996 World Cup winning team. He's also now the author of a book, My Innings, Roshan Mahanama, Retired Hurt to the Best View of the Game, which will be available online everywhere in a few weeks' time. Roshan, we've been talking about Sri Lanka cricket, what has happened to our team. A lot of people, when there's a match, what I've seen is on social media, let's say even you, if by any chance if you bat well, praises. The moment you don't do one single, you know, you get retired and you hurt yourself,
blames in a very bad way. So, I mean, people don't understand these players are also people who with feelings, they can see what's going on and the pressure they have. The whole nation is trying to say, you know, get us a win. That amount of pressure nobody at home will ever get. They can pretty much sit in front of the television and scream at the TV and say this. But you all have gone through it and you understand the mentality of the players right now. What I've seen is too much of cricket. For some say these team members, these players have been pulled from this to that to this to that, and you also need to ask the question at one particular point: health factors. Isn't this, you know, it is not just an easy game to go there, you know, whack the bat and then come home. I mean, it's tiring. It's tremendously taking a toll on your health and everything. What do you think? What 2023 World Cup is coming? 2 years down the line? We have a little bit of time. What are the tweaks we need to do, we need to understand, and pretty much have a goal? Maybe 2023 might be our 1996 again.
I think, Mahesh, you need to plan well. Now we've got three formats. Some countries, yes, people might think that they're playing too much of cricket, but how I see it is a career of a sportsman is very short. Commercial aspect is good, but it's very important that you have a balance. People need to figure out what sort of tours to bring in, mm-hmm. what sort of franchise leagues they should be playing in, and also we need to protect the players and identify what format they're good at. So that's very important. I felt that we were very late in identifying those players for this recently concluded
T20
World Cup. So we need to identify those players, give them exposure, get them to figure out their own game, what is expected from them from a team's point of view, have the balance, give them those responsibilities. Because I feel somebody will learn the technique until they're about 17, 18. From 19 onwards, or until 17, I would say 75 to 80% would be your technique talent, but mind takes over. So you need to be, you were talking about being physical fit, but they say if you're physically fit, you'll be mentally fit also, you'll be mentally tougher. So there is a mental aspect that people need to figure out as well. So we need to, I don't think that we are short of talent. Unfortunately, like I mentioned before, our tournaments have got diluted a bit. We have come together to try and give our views. That's all we can do. We have no authority to go and implement some of these things that we feel that will help to improve the game. But these are areas that we will have to focus. But coming back to the 2023 World Cup, before we get there, we have a path leading up to the 2023 World Cup. We've got a Test Championship. We've just started. We've played our first game. The boys have done well. We are all proud of them. You said, yes, the critics... it's easy for people to criticize. I know these boys are under a lot of pressure, but I feel it's not their fault. It's purely because they have not been guided well. For me, I think cricket is a game of disciplines. So first you have to have your disciplines off field that will take you into the middle. Why have they brought in a match referee? Yes, maybe to assist the on-field umpires in terms of certain responsibilities. A referee would not interfere in the traditional role of the umpire, but the referee is in charge of the game. I cover that, like I told you before, a bit about it in the book. But sometimes the commercial side of things can get into the players. They forget that no one's bigger than the game. It's all about the game. And I also feel that for these youngsters, they need to make the maximum in that shorter period of time. But you should focus on your game, what needs to be done, and if you're not willing to make those sacrifices, it'll be very difficult for a player to progress. People are short-sighted, and that can be one of the reasons that some of these players fall into these unwanted traps. But it's important from an administrator's point of view, from the selector's point of view, to identify these players. Like I mentioned, the Test Championship is important. Now there's a lot of focus on that. Then the 2023 World Cup. Prior to that, I think we have another T20 World Cup next year. So there's a lot of planning that takes place. All these coaches have to be aligned. We have under 19 coaches. We have a development squad, a Sri Lankan A team, a squad. So these coaches have to be aligned to identify players. We have got talent scouts now. If you want to go, not look at the next year or two, identify players who can be your future potential players. So that's important. Once you identify these players, it's about giving them confidence. I feel we have sometimes played far too many players. There was a period where I read somewhere that about 40-50 players played in a short period of about a year or two. That is not on. You need to be fair by some of these players. Tell them what is expected of them and make them accountable.
That falls on that role of that particular job falls on the coach. And we've seen like numerous number of coaches coming into Sri Lanka. We try to do this, getting foreigners to come and pretty much understand. Now, Dave Watmore was one of the the winning coach that we had for in 1996, which we all have worked very closely. What kind of coaching, do we need to get foreigners to come in and help us? Or do you think we already have people like yourself to take over? And we've seen Shamil Nawaz helping with the bowling side of things. A lot of players are opting to help. Mahela Jayawardena is part of it. All these great cricketers who've done very well in their discipline now coming back and trying to give back. People like you, when y'all cannot, in order to give the same way that others are doing, y'all do in a different format. Y'all say, y'all give advice, y'all say all these kind of, even right now, that's what you're doing. And so, where do you think we need to start changing on that mentality? Because is the answer lies abroad with the coach, or where can we make that tweak?
First, I just need to mention this. When we spoke to Dev at the end of the 96 World Cup and we wanted him to be part of some of these celebrations, and he said, no, it's you guys who did the job. A coach is as good as his players. Yeah. So the players do have a responsibility. If you keep changing coaches, it's not going to help the system. It's not going to help the players. There was a time, from my point of view again, we had to depend on foreign coaches. But now my personal view is that we can move away. We do have the people. We need to make them accountable and get them to have a professional approach. And also, we should work on not letting our people who have excelled, who have done well, can be as a player, can be as a coach, going overseas, working for other countries. We need to make an effort to keep them. So to do that, I think we need to move away from this mindset. If you're a Sri Lankan, you need to pay an X amount. If you are a foreigner, that's what it is. No, it is a job that will decide what the remuneration is going to be. And irrespective of whether it's a foreigner or a local, if that is the going rate in the sport, you have to make that payment. Because in Sri Lanka, I know my dear friend Chandika Hathurasinghe was here. Everyone was talking about what he was getting. I don't know what negotiations they had. That's personal, right? Then if they have agreed, So that means that's what he's worth. I'm sure they must be paying something pretty much similar to the current coach. So remuneration also plays a huge part. It should not be the factor for someone to select the job. You have to have the passion, you have to have the knowledge, you have to have a vision and the drive to coach a team. But also for them, they need to be comfortable if they know that they're worth much more if they go and work outside. Yes. And the other thing is, they should not, when I say the administrators, should never interfere in the role of a coach. You have to make the coach accountable. What happens is, why we are looking at a foreign coach is, when we have a foreign coach, we feel that the amount of interference will be minimum. You get one of our own guys. Sri Lanka is a small place. I know when they got to know that we are part of a committee that has been appointed by the minister to see how we can suggest some improvements for cricket, people started to approach me who have been involved in different
sectors
of the game. Can be umpires, referees, cricketers from different clubs, schools. So people who are going to be selected also have to be strong and be firm, and they should be able to walk the talk. I feel in life, people should walk the talk. Sadly, we don't see in this country, even at the topmost level, people walking the talk. So a coach will command that respect if he can be firm, and then if he can be accountable. So changing coaches are also not the solution, but finding the right coach and giving him that authority and giving him that confidence. So it's a combined effort, and currently everyone is talking about the coach of the national team, but we need to look at all the other coaches as well. We need to get qualified, good coaches to come and handle all the teams, starting from the under-19 team. I think we've been able to now identify people, but it's just a matter of putting these structures in place. But once you put the structures, don't interfere. If you have a issue, then call for explanation and see whether that's valid. If it's not, then you can make suggestions. But otherwise, how can you make somebody accountable if you force him to do certain things that you feel that's right? So there has to be a synergy between the coaches, the administrators, the selectors. I think that is where we lack. We pull in different directions, and I know for a fact it has filtered down to the grassroots levels as well. People should look at the bigger picture from my point of view if we are to do well going forward.
Cricket has always been a game that has unified a lot of Sri Lankans together, come and cheer for one flag, one nation, and it has proven time and time after. I think there is a lot to learn from that game, and also how people's emotions are being utilized in order to feel one particular aspect of things. It's just the winning, the country winning, which I want to talk about as we move on to the next segment. Before that, let's take a short commercial break. I'm in conversation with cricketing legend Roshan Mahanama.
We'll be right back.
Welcome back, everyone, to Get Real. I'm in conversation with cricketing legend Roshan Mahanama. He's also the author of his new book, My Innings, Roshan Mahanama, Retired Hurt to the Best of the Best View of the Game. This book will be available, I think, somewhere around mid-December. And also, if by any chance, if I can, it's not only in English, if you can get a shot of this, it's also in Sinhala as well, pretty much. Try to understand if you can show it to our viewers. If you are an interesting cricket fan, there's a lot of knowledge and experience and everything in wealth in Sinhala as well, and it's in English. Make sure that you get a copy of this. I hope this is my copy. Roshan, we've been talking about what Sri Lanka cricket needs to do in order to get to a pinnacle point by 2023, hopefully, to get this country to understand how much we can utilize, not just as a sport, but as a unifying factor for the nation, because our country is divided. We all know we are trying to segregate ourselves, calling this name, that name, trying to label ourselves, and we say, but then the person who suffers is the country, and we don't understand that. And recently, I think I read a quote from Murali where he was addressing young cricketers, and he said, apparently, we need to understand, despite the fact that, you know, we love the game, we try to do our level best, only 11 people can get into the sport of cricket. And those 11 people are representing the nation. So the responsibility is not just about you, it's about the whole country as a whole. Roshan Mahanama is not there. Sri Lanka is there, is what I mean, our hopes, our thoughts, everything is being carried by you. What do you think? How we see a lot of other disciplines coming in. We have the LPL, IPL, all these, and it is getting commercialized very fast. Casualty is the national game. Casualty seems to be like the national game, and we don't see that kind of performance happening in the national level. What do you think,
Mahesh? For me, it is a bit sad, but by saying that, if you want to use it to your advantage, like what India has done, Australia up to an extent, and some other countries are trying, I know Pakistan, I can proudly say, I don't think there'll be anyone who has officiated in as many tournaments as me. I've done 19 franchise leagues, close to 250 T20 matches, and I know how they operate. But for me, what it hurts is they are brought in the football model, and a friend of mine recently told me a footballer, for him to play for his country, he needs to get permission from the club, which is very sad. So we were taught to put your country above anything else. So that's a balance that we need to bring in to in sports. Looking at Sri Lanka, we are trying to follow some of these other countries by having different tournaments, but we need to figure out first what suits us, and if we have identified that, then we need to be on par with what the other countries are, some of the other countries are doing. Now, if you're looking at franchise leagues, the model is IPL. A lot of the countries are focusing to model their own domestic franchise league tournament to similar to the IPL. I have officiated in seven IPLs. When we started the first franchise league a few years ago, it was a flop.
The LPL?
Not the LPL, but I think it was called SLPL, if I'm not mistaken. The first one. Even to date, I don't think they have got the model right. There is a issue. I told you that we were appointed by the minister into a technical advisory committee. They have not sought our advice. So where do we fit in? That's one of the things that hurts me also. And I'm wondering at times whether we've been called upon just to do certain parts of what needs to be done, and some will be done by others. It should be a joint effort. I told you before as well, if we are to put this right, our vision has to be clear. We need to have the heart to do it. You cannot be having hidden agendas. What will happen is, if we don't do that, it will filter to the players. Don't forget, we Sri Lankans, I'm talking about the sporting personalities, come from humble backgrounds, right? They need to make a living in that 10 years, 15 years, I told you, to go on for the rest of their lives. So it's a very short career. People will say that, they shouldn't be spoiled. No, I don't agree to that. Yes, let them make that kind of money. But money shouldn't be everything. And these players have to be guided, groomed, told what needs to be done. You need to look at the bigger picture. But if you don't get the house in order, if you don't have the right people setting that examples, how can you expect your players? You were just saying prior to this as well, you know, how can we help Sri Lanka cricket to another level, or for us to see
a different side, yeah.
A different side of winning another World Cup. Our dream is that we won one T20 World Cup and the 1996 World Cup. But since then, I must tell you, the players who followed after us have, you know, they maintained, and we made it to about what
two
subsequently, and altogether three or four T20 World Cups. But I think we were very lucky. We had the systems that were put in place prior to that, and those players came through that system. And the system not being right, we are seeing the effects of that. So we need to fix it. You bring in a LPL, and then you have a negative impact from the time they launch it. How can that be? For me, I can't see that we are sending a strong message across, and it reflects bad on the country itself. And then it's easy for us to say that it's not done by us, but it's done by someone else. But if this organization is holding something, your organization is responsible. You can't put the blame on someone else. So that's something that I feel needs to be looked at. And I think we need to seriously think of streamlining some of these things.
Roshan, very inspirational words to leave our segment and our program for tonight. You have inspired us in the field. You've done your part. We were cheering for you when you were, doing your level best. And at that moment, it bore its eyes. And right now, you're still doing it with this bookie. Roshan Mahanama, retired head to the best view of the game, the author of that. It has been an honor to have had this chat with you. Thank you very much for being on the show.
Thank you, Mahesh, for having me.
All right, that's all the time we have for you tonight. In case you missed this show, you can recapture it on our YouTube channel, youtube.com/otherderanaenglish. And also from tonight, you can also talk to us via Facebook. Just search for our page at Get Real Derana, and you will come across Get Real Facebook page. Make sure that you utilize it to have a conversation with us. That's all the time we have for you. Remember to stay positive, test negative. I'll see you next time. Goodbye. Fight.